during the episode picks of the German ARD series Polizeiruf 110, a lawyer is interrogated. Without being prompted, the lawyer explains the reason for the unpopularity of members of his profession, seemingly anticipating expected criticism. He mentions that the specialized language was originally developed to disenfranchise lay people, a belief held by many, and many feel that the lawyers prevent them from understanding their own rights. This immediately reminds me of a conversation between my uncle and his niece, who studies law. He simply wanted to know how much longer she needed to study at the university. His question was straightforward. How long do you need until you are finished? The exact wording is not important. We understand that the question targets a point in time, and my uncle expected an estimate, not an exact date. Unfortunately, the prospective lawyer provided all sorts of responses, but did not give him a clear answer. She could have responded with a single word like 2030, implying by the year 2030, or could have elaborated upon a request with approximately. She could have specified the year more precisely, perhaps in the form of pessimistically by 2032. After several back and forth queries and pleas for a concise answer, she seemed to have taken something away from him. My uncle felt dispossessed of his ability to communicate. At least he seemed to contemplate whether he lacked intellect. Sometimes we recognize ourselves or something about ourselves in the mirror of the other. And I was startled by the thought that I might not express myself sufficiently, not listen well enough, and thus might generally lack good communication skills. I also remembered my father accusing me several times of not being able to speak properly, and I remembered my resolve to work on it if necessary. Secondly, I remembered the legendary lecture by the professor of computer science Patrick Winston and his realization of that our success in life is significantly determined by our ability to speak, to write, and lastly, by the quality of our ideas. Winston's lectures reinforced my resolutions.
And that's because your success in life will be determined largely by your ability to speak, your ability to write, and the quality of your ideas, in that order. I know that I can be successful in this because the quality of communication, your speaking, your writing, is largely determined by this formula. It's a matter of how much knowledge you have, how much you practice with that knowledge, and your inherent talent.
For inspiration or role models, we did not turn to the usual giants in language mastery, like Luther, Nietzsche, Goethe, Hegel, Kafka, Mann, etc. Nor do we take the pedagogically unmatched style guide by Reiners or his Art of Speech. No, we keep it as simple as possible and consider here the two most important principles of speaking: understanding and authenticity. Knowledge of principles, knowledge about aspects of communication, is more important than practicing them. At least for Professor Winston, knowledge about good communication takes precedence over practice, and I agree with him. A good and simple technique for clear speaking is pyramidal speaking, which I was able to observe particularly well during the Nord reportage, Meat Salad and Grill Meatball, about the shop owner Egon Manke. Whether to a customer, his son, a friend, or the reporter, he always first succinctly states the most important thing and then, at a faster pace and somewhat quieter, the details. His good style was immediately noticeable to me, and I hope that it is not just subjective. The questions to Manke are assumed by me since they are not heard in the video. I also created the answers due to the lack of transcription. Question: what is available for purchase here? Manke's answer: well, you can actually say from the hooks to the deck to the head, everything in between you can get here, and food and drink, of course. Less well would be, my wife sometimes spreads minced meat sandwiches. We now also have fresh vegetables twice a week. Our assortment is growing. Over there you will also find sewing, stuff, etc. Question: tell us a little about the store. How long has it been here? How long have you been working here? Anke's answer: the store opened on January the 1st, officially opened. I was born on January 21st, so it's 3 weeks older than me. That's something, right? Yeah, no, you get to know your way around here. As well would be, my father wanted to supply the villagers and my mother was etc. Question, tell us about the area, other stores, the economy etc. Manke's answer, so how everything has changed here in our countryside. We had here in Wintermoor, they all lived from agriculture, almost all, a few probably who did something else, they had livestock, all mixed up, but that's all gone. In Schneverdingen, which is the larger place here nearby, there were 16 shoe factories. Of the 16, none are left. They are all gone. Then we had 5 such innkeepers where you could drink beer and had a bit of entertainment, also gone. My analysis, Manke immediately says that nothing is like it was. Everything has changed, which is businesses are gone, etc. is secondary. Question, how is your son doing? Manke's answer, he's doing well. Diligent, reliable, neat, keeps the store nice and tidy. No, you can't say otherwise. He got all the good stuff. My analysis, again, first the most important thing in a short sentence that the son is good, and then in the subordinate clause the details. Manke to a customer. Of everyone here, he has the most money here in our area. He built a power plant and is still involved in 50% in another power plant. He earns 3,900 marks a day here. You can believe it or not. And half as much at the other one. So he has 5,000 marks a day. Excuse me. Then further Manke. Yes, we always have a lot to talk about. About all that lies behind us and what we'll still have ahead of us. Only the way is not so long anymore. 85, I first said. We want to become and then we want to see further. Only he will get older, because his parents also become so old. He will outlive us. As a role model in terms of uniqueness, authenticity and truthfulness, former heavyweight boxer Mike Tyson immediately comes to mind. Sitting opposite an interview or conversation partner, with a fearless look, he takes the time to think or just to gather his thoughts, because there are no blockages, stress, worries about image loss, showing off, etc. He just wants to put it in a certain understandable form, but not change the content. When asked about his time in prison, he says,
I've been there. I'm not saying I've been in jail. I'm a hardcore. No, because there's a bunch of homosexuals, a bunch of weak people in jail. And the reason why people go to jail because they don't have the shit in check. And they're not, they can't manage their life. So that don't mean you're a bad guy because you're in jail. It means you're pretty much a dysfunctional, weak individual and can't manage your life outside in the world. So that don't mean you're a tough guy. It's easy for somebody to shank somebody or beat up people over 10 or 12 guys or something. But I'm talking about man for man, bravo for bravo. I can stand up with any man. Red blood, blue blood, whoever they are.
So he emphasizes that the prison is full of people who can't manage their lives. This, according to Tyson, doesn't make them bad people, but dysfunctional and weak individuals. Furthermore, he distances himself from the idea that physical superiority in a group proves strength. Instead, he defines true strength as the ability to measure oneself in direct, fair single combat, regardless of the social or biological origin of the opponents. If Tyson wanted to impress and be concerned about his image, he might have answered something like this. During my time in prison, I underwent a major significant transformation. I faced very tough challenges. During the time, I learned that you don't get stronger by inflicting pain on others, but by staying true to your principles. We easily recognize the inauthentic behavior here. In an interview with Tucker Carlson, Tyson is asked about his feelings toward his ring opponents.
How did you feel about the guys you were in the ring with?
I wanted to kill them.
Well, I can tell. Why did, I'm laughing nervously. You really felt that way? You wanted.
Yeah.
How did you get yourself into a frame of mind where you wanted to kill them?
Just think about who I am. I don't want to go back there no more. I don't want to be. I don't want to be in that poverty state of mind anymore. And not from a physical perspective. I don't want to be poverty struck in here.
Yeah. So would you sit and think about it before a fight? Think about the guy you were fighting?
Absolutely. The more you hurt them, the higher you go in life. In fact, that's just my mentality. That's the more you hurt them, the more people love you.
Wow, that's pretty intense. And true, I guess.
Again, typically for Tyson, he expresses his feelings and his past in a very direct way. If he had not honestly said that he had no strong emotions against his opponents or that he just wanted to win, then it would show a detached and indifferent attitude, and it would contradict his passion and emotional depth. We as viewers would have gained nothing. When asked about his idols as a child or a teenager, someone from the audience calls out Muhammad Ali.
When Mike was younger, who did he want to be like? Who did he aspire to be?
Yeah.
I wanted to be... No. It's interesting you say I didn't want to be like Muhammad Ali, because where I came from, Muhammad Ali didn't come from the world I came from. I came from filth and scum and sewage. So I wanted to be mean like Sonny Liston and Jack Dempsey. I wanted to be ferocious. I wanted to kill you with my stare. I wasn't like Muhammad Ali. I love and respect Muhammad Ali, but Muhammad Ali is not like me. He don't come from the world I come from.
Tyson thus makes it clear that he distinguishes himself from Ali, because their origins and therefore their worldviews are very different. Ali was known for his elegant style and his societal influence. In contrast, Tyson comes from a world of dirt, scum, etc., and that made him rough and aggressive. Therefore, he identifies more with fighters like Sonny Liston and Jack Dempsey, who are known for their toughness and wildness. A non-authentic answer aimed at impressing the audience and taking a politically correct stance might have sounded like this. Ali was undoubtedly one of the greatest boxers of all time, and of course I always looked up to him. His elegance in the ring and his commitment outside of it were inspiring. I tried to follow in his footsteps, both as an athlete and as an activist. He paved the way for fighters like me, and I am proud to be part of his legacy. The considerations of Manke and Tyson are intended to illustrate the two principles or demands for understandability and truthfulness. At best, they also provide impulses and critically examining and optimizing our own way of communication.